So welcome, and thank you to all the HSC staff. You know, there's a great saying by the French philosopher Jack Rousseau: there is no greater wisdom than human kindness. And to title my talk, All Parenting Starts With Self, and I was saying there that it's really quite strange that parenting is still not seen as a profession, because the effect that we have on children is huge, right? And for me, parents have such a privileged position. They offer one of the most unselfish gifts of life to a child. And what's important, of course, they want to be there for the child, but you can only be there for the child to the degree that you are there for yourself. I always say the only relationship that you need to attend to in this world is the one with yourself. Because if that's a place where you love yourself, you believe in yourself, you nurture yourself, you listen to yourself, you care for yourself, you encourage yourself, then you will automatically do that with the child. In other words, what we're not doing for ourselves, we will not be in a place to do for a child. And the source of that, you know, is in our own stories. I remember a woman that came to see me, and she at some point said to me, Tony, I don't love my children. She had two children. She was separated. Husband had had major addictions. And when she said that to me, I don't love my children, I said to her, I feel so privileged that you would tell me that. I really thank you. Because who else would you say that to? What would your fear be if you said, I don't love my children? And surely the fear would be, I'd be judged. And the fear of what other people think is, talk about pandemic, but is epidemic, right? And when we get to know ourselves as persons, we need to go from that place of fearfulness to the place of fearlessness, which, as we'll see in a few minutes, is what we started out with. And when she said that to me, I don't love my children, I said to her, tell me, how do you feel about yourself? Oh, I feel nothing for myself. I don't have any sense of my worth or value. And I said, when you were a child, what happened? Well, there was no expression of love in the family. There was no hugs. There was no intimacy. There was no expression of affection or warmth. And I said, well, you very wisely then, unconsciously, stopped reaching out to others for love because you were experiencing abandonment all the time. And that was deep pain. And so you wisely now just, you know, stayed apart from people, even your own child unconsciously. And I actually met her, one of our boys, she had two boys at one stage, and for about 20 minutes, and we had a lovely chat and lovely contact. And when he was going, I said to him, I really love my contact with you. I really enjoyed our chat, and I'm really going to miss you. Now, it's very important. When you say something, you need to mean it. You need to feel it, because children can read us like books. And for months afterwards, he would say to his mother, Tony said he'd miss me. And of course, how clever of the child. Mom, if I've seen, you know, Tony only for 20 minutes, he said he misses me. How is it after 9 years, I've never heard you say that, Mom? And that was the indirect message. And it was very interesting. At one stage, the mother rang me up and she said, this boy had developed obsessive compulsive disorder. And I said, oh, tell me, what is it? Well, she said, he believes now that all adults are germs. And if he goes sit in a chair where they're sat, or he goes near them, he's going to get infected. And also, she said, he believes they all smell. And I said, something very deep going on there. I said, because all human behavior makes sense. There's no madness. When you really examine the story, you'll always find a meaning to behavior. So I said, I'd love to talk with your son, right? So he came to see me, and we connected quite quickly. And eventually I said to him, I know what's brought you here. Your mom has told me that you believe that all adults have germs. Yeah. And And that if you sit where they sat or do you go near them, you get infected. Yeah. And that they smell too. Yeah. And I said, tell me, how have adults been with you? And he said, they've hurt me. His father would keep promising to turn up time and time again, never turned up, right? And then we heard that his mother was only beginning to work on herself in terms of being able to give her affection to herself before she could begin to give it to her child. And I said, aren't you my little genius? That you know adults have hurt you and you have found a very clever way to stay away from them, not even look in their direction or go near or even sit where they sat, because now you protect yourself from hurt. How very clever of you. And then I said to him, I'm an adult and you're here with me now in the room. Do I have germs? You get germs from me? Do I smell? Oh, no, he said. No, I know you love me. And children know. So it was fascinating with him as well. His mom was doing very good work and she began to be able to be affectionate towards herself, began to source the reasons why she hadn't expressed love to herself or to her children. And slowly but surely, step by step, she was on the path, the road less traveled. And generally when they would watch television together, his brother and himself and his mother, they would, you know how children love to lean in on us when they're sitting with us? No, that would never have happened. But the child had sensed something happening with his mother and he would begin to play footsie with her when they sat watching television on the couch. And so he was testing the waters, wasn't he? And she eventually got to a stage where she could hug him. And after about 6 months of being hugged, the mother asked him one day, how do you feel now when I hug you? And he said, Mom, I don't feel you hate me anymore. How wise of the child. Am I going to suddenly now feel that I'm loved and be confident about it? So I don't feel you hate me anymore, Mom. And Mom continued to do the work on herself, deepening her relationship with herself. Remember, it's only what you can give yourself, you can give to another. What you're not giving to yourself, you won't be giving to another. So about 6 months later, she says to him, and she had, you know, become more affectionate with him and so on. How do you feel now when I hug you? She said, ah, Mom, you've done great work. So Freud captures that kind of scene that I've talked about. He talks about what a distressing contrast there is between the radiant mind of the child and the feeble mentality of the average adult. And Freud, I, you know, the radiant mind of the child, I'm always mesmerized by babies and toddlers, and we had a lot of them visiting or relatives and so on. And their fearlessness, right? Their curiosity, right? Their affectionate, right? Their daredevil behavior, their energy, their concentration. Oh my God, it's our nature. That's our nature. We are fearless. We are radiant. And then we encounter the feeble mentality of the average adult. Because Freud missed something very important. Who develops feeble mentality? And the person who develops feeble mentality is the child in response to the feeble mentality of the parent or the teacher or whatever. And that's wisdom. It's like, you know, like the boy described developing the obsessive compulsive behaviors as a way of protecting himself from further hurt. And so if as a child I go all nervous and anxious and unsure or I'm screaming or whatever, there is something happening around the relationship with a parent or with a teacher or maybe a childminder that is now a threat to the child's well-being. And when a child is troubled and troubling, they're not trying to make life difficult. for adults. They are trying to show how difficult life is for them. And is there any adult in the place that would spot that for them? Because I can only spot it for them when I spot it for myself. And there's none of us who doesn't need to examine our story. Aristotle, a life examined is a life lived. And that's why I'm saying as a profession, parenting as a profession, we need the opportunities to examine our lives before we dare take on the responsibility for bringing another life into this world, right? And be assured that we will be there for the children in a way that will support their fearless minds, their radiant mind, so that they won't have to hide it in the face of threat. And Jung, Freud's friend and colleague, writes, puts it well as well. He said, what is unconscious in the parent is transmitted to the child. And the child's unconscious response will remain a continual block to a fuller life, unless at some point that child as a young person becomes conscious, or the parent becomes conscious, like the story I told you, where at that point it became conscious, then our whole relationship with ourselves then transmitted to the child, and the child now began to receive her love and began to become more secure. So it's like when the child encounters, you know, the unconscious behavior of the parent, and I'm stressing the word unconscious, because I can assure you, no parent ever deliberately wants to hurt a child. And I think one of the lines I've heard from so many parents, fathers and mothers over the years, Tony, I didn't realize what I was doing. And I say to them, of course you didn't. If you had realized, of course you wouldn't do it. And I love the word realize, because it means you see things, but realize when you now are conscious, oh my God, how I was with my child, I hadn't realized the sources of that from my own childhood. And it reminds me of a story that a mother who came to me at the end of some lecture, and she was telling me about her 15-year-old boy, who was the bane of teachers' lives in school. He would refuse to do any school work. He never had done any homework during all his time in school. And when she would try to get him to do his homework, he would always, you know, get aggressive with her and sometimes kick and hit her. And she said she was at her wit's end. And I was saying to her, I'd love to talk to your son, right? Because for me, you know, that remember again, when a child's behavior is troubled and troubling, there's something hidden going on. There's something unconscious going on. There's something what wants to come to the surface to be seen. So when he came to see me, I eventually said to him, you know, your mom has told me about your situation in school, you're not doing homework, that you get aggressive with her when she tries to get you to do your homework, you can kick her, hit her. And I said to him, I made a mistake, right? And I love mistakes because I learn from them. I mean, how many of us embrace mistakes as opportunities? We learn more from mistakes than we do from successes. And the mistake I made was, I said, how do you feel, I'll say his name was John. John, how do you feel, John, you know, how do you think a mother feels when you kick and hit her? And his response was, I don't give a fuck, right? And I caught it. Because here he's sitting in front of me and I'm talking about his mother. And then I said to him, John, you know, I know that when somebody is hurt, you know, that and when they're aggressive and when they're violent, is because they have been very deeply hurt. And he started roaring crying. And now he's giving expression to what lies hidden. And the origins of it, that when he was 4 years of age, his father was a tradesperson, a perfectionist with a very short fuse. Remember, tone of voice accounts for most human misery. It cuts much deeper than any sap, right? And the look that kills, right, can cut very deeply. And this father was a perfectionist. He had his tool shed. He had never allowed a child near the tool shed. He had to have everything perfect in the tool shed. Everything had its place. But on one day, when he went off to work in the morning, for the first time ever, he forgot to lock the tool shed. And I can assure you, there's no better person than a four-year-old to find an unlocked door, right, or an unlocked press. They're so curious. They'll check things out. So he went into his tool shed, and there he was, things he'd never seen before. He was so excited. He pulled everything out, right? And at the end of the day, when the father came home at 6 o'clock, he opened the shed door, and there is everything scattered all over the place, all around the ground. And did he say to his son, "Oh my God, what a wonderful day you've had. I'm looking forward to you telling me about it." No. He kicked the child, he beat the child. He put the child to bed without any food. He didn't talk to the child for something like 6 to 8 weeks. And that child learned something very, very wise. Work is dangerous. Curiosity is dangerous. If I show it, I lose the attention and the love of one of the most important persons in my life, my father. And if that happens with my father, well, will that happen in school as well? And so he wisely stopped showing curiosity. And it was interesting, there was only one teacher in the school, secondary school he was in, who had shown kindness to him, that he would do a little work for. And it comes back again to what I was saying about the first story, that children pick up when we express love for them. They know it, right? And so they slowly then begin to come out of hiding. So I said to him, "How do you feel if I talk with your dad about this whole story and what has happened for you?" And he said, "I'd like that." So his dad did come to see me. And when he did, I thanked him for coming, just, you know, that I needed his support around his son's violence towards his mother and aggression and not doing schoolwork. My God, the father hit the roof. Because, again, I made another mistake that I assumed that the father knew about the difficulties with the mother, but of course she hadn't told him. And remember then that passivity, if the mother is passive, then she's not there for the boy. And if the father is aggressive, he's not there for the boy. This boy had nobody except the one teacher. So anyway, eventually I peeled him off the ceiling. And I said, "I'd like to tell you your son's story." And I told him the story. And he began to cry. And he used that lovely line I used earlier. Tony said, "I didn't realize what I was doing. I didn't realize what I was doing." And I said, "Of course you didn't. I know you wouldn't have done it if you had realized it." He said, "You know, if I'd been hard on my boy," he said, "my father was absolutely vicious with me to get everything right." And you know, human suffering is generational. It's not genetic. It goes from generation to generation, unless we get the opportunity in safety, in holding, to re-examine our lives and to bring out of hiding all the traumas that we dare not speak about. And so I was saying to the father, "What an opportunity you have now to go to your son and tell him your story and how it's impacted your life and how that impacted his life and how together now you can work together to enjoy work, not to be perfectionist around it, but enjoy it. And then for your son to feel the curiosity and the fearlessness around work again." So where we are is also where we need to be, right? There is no wrong behavior. There is no bad behavior. Once we judge behavior as wrong or bad, we actually now have shut the door between ourselves and another person. And it's important we look to understand what lies hidden, what wants to come to the surface that I dare not speak about, I say, over a good number of years, right? So there's always a story. It's always such a revelation. It's always such a privilege, in fact, to really sit with people's story Everybody has a story. And to get to the deeper meaning of how is it that I became so passive or aggressive or work addicted, or you take, you know, a lot of alcohol addictions, drug addictions, which are very strong nowadays. What's the source, right? I remember working with a 14-year-old, right? And he became addicted to gin when he was age 9. And at age 14, he was very much addicted to various drugs, right? And I was saying to him, how do you feel when you take the gin and the drugs? He said, Tony, I feel great, right? Now, again, very, very violent father, very passive mother. And I said to him, do you think I'm going to take your drugs away from you now? Because without them, you wouldn't have survived, right? You found a way to survive in a very dark home atmosphere. What a genius you have been. But what I would love to do, with your permission, I would like to talk with your parents. And I remember when the parents came, they didn't realize what they were doing. Of course they didn't. And gradually, as the relationships changed, then the boys' need for the addiction slowly began to evaporate. Always meaning to even the most troublesome behavior. The German poet Rilke puts it so well, everything terrible is something crying out for love. So, yeah. One of the things I often say with parents, right, that the one-to-one relationship with each child is very important. Because children need to be seen for their specialness, for their uniqueness, for their individuality. And if we always take them together, somehow they will act up in some way. They will communicate, I need to be seen for myself. And imagine one woman in one of my courses in UCC approached me. She had three children, three girls, aged 12, 10 and 8. And she was saying to me that the 12-year-old was really giving her a hard time. She was being rebellious. She was being oppositional, difficult, and she didn't know what to do about it. And I said to her, I'm just curious. I said, your daughter, she's the 12-year-old. Her nose has been put out of joint twice by the 10-year-old and the 8-year-old. But I'm wondering, do you ever spend any one-to-one time with her? Oh, no, she said, I won't stay the children together. I said, I'd love for you to experiment during the week and just spend some time, one-to-one time with her. Anyway, she came back the following week and she said to me, you know, Tony, on Monday, I was bringing three children to school. I put two younger ones in the first. And I said to the the older one, the 12-year-old, listen, no, you and I are going to have a day together, right? And we're going to go into town, we're going to have coffee, we're going to do some shopping, we'll have a lovely lunch together. And the child turned around to her and said, Mum, I've been waiting my whole life for you to say that. So we never know. And having conversations with children are so important. Inquiring about where they are, what they're feeling, what are their needs, right? What would they like? Conversations, right? So, and in terms of parenting, right, that, and in any relationship, separateness is the basis for all relationships, right? The more I have my own life, the more I bring my fullness of my life, whether to a partner, to my child, to my colleague, to a student in the classroom, the more I don't have my life, then I tend to be codependent, I tend to be enmeshed with other people's lives, looking for something from them that I need to be giving myself, and that can be with partner or children as well. And one of the very important kind of developments that needs to happen when we begin to examine our lives with safety is slowly but surely to separate. We need to fly the nest and we need to come back as larger persons, our own person. And so for me, then relationship is where I bring my fullness to the other and experience the fullness of the other. And then, of course, relationships. They just radiate back to radiant mind, right? They're just so fulfilling. But it's not been in our culture to really look at, for the most important people in our society, parents, how do we create the opportunities for parents to come to that separate place, to come into that that lovely line by John O'Donohue, the inhabitation of our own individuality, living in our own interiority, occupying our own person. How do we create the opportunities for parents to do that? But just not parents, political leaders, any people who have power over others need to be sure that they have power over themselves so they don't have to overpower others. The Ronald Reagan, when he was being inaugurated, maybe somebody else wrote it for him, but it was a great line. And the line was, if you haven't learned to govern yourself, how can you govern a country? If you haven't got the opportunity to learn to parent yourself, how can you effectively parent children? If you haven't learned to, you know, manage your own world, how can you manage a group in the workplace? If you're not leader of yourself, how can you be leader of anything else? And we need those opportunities to become managers and leaders of ourselves. Yeah, so now where am I? How much time have I got?
Well, Tony, you've just hit us bang on the button.
Have I? Okay, yeah. Let me just finish so on one.
We have some questions for you, Tony.
Okay, let me just finish on one line. Yeah.
One line.
Yeah. One of the most common illusions is that we all came from happy families. And that's a very wise illusion because it's very hard for us to challenge what happened to us in the adults in our lives. And that's why we need support to actually come into the reality. Everybody suffers. Parents do their best, teachers do their best, but we all suffer to some degree, some greatly, some, but there's none of us who hasn't suffered. And we deserve the opportunities to examine what that suffering was. Okay, it's questions. Thank you.
Tony, that was the longest line I've ever come across. You're a man of words.
You recorded it, did you?
You're a man of words. Yes, it is recorded. We have some questions coming in, Tony. One from Teresa, she says, hello, Tony. If you could give one golden nugget to help parents, support their children as they're growing into adulthood, what would that be? Just one golden nugget in one line, Tony.
Well, I'm going to give two golden nuggets. Love is so important, unconditional love, right? No strings attached to it. But the other thing that's very important is belief. And I remember a teenager sitting in front of me one day and we were chatting and he said, Tony, belief is everything. And I was saying to him, I think love comes first, but you're absolutely right. Belief is a very close second.
Yeah. That's a very good answer. Love and belief. That's very nice. Okay. Also, another question here. Just bear with me, Tony, for a second. We have an enthusiastic child who has lost motivation for schoolwork, music, gymnastics. She turned 8 in April. She's the oldest of 3. She's certainly grieved change. Mom is obviously nursing 3 days a week and found the momentum quite hard. Dad is out farming. It's quite a busy time at the farm at the moment. Could Tony advise? We're trying our best to catch up, but full-time schooling is very difficult. What advice could you give Tony?
Catch up with schooling, is it? Yeah?
Yes. Lost motivation for basically school, work, music, gymnastics, everything, the child.
Yeah, and what I would want to do, a child is 8 years of age, right? Like I said earlier, I would want to have a conversation with her. Tell me what's happening for you. How is it that, you know, that you're not enjoying these things? What needs to happen for you to begin to enjoy them again? But have the conversation. I can assure you, the child always knows. Don't assume what a child wants. The child will tell you what they want. But we need to have the conversation.
Yeah, that's very interesting. I suppose a lot of people don't realise that you can have a good, solid conversation with an agent.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. And it's like some of the stories I've told you. Should the conversations and what emerged in conversations, whether it was an 8-year-old or a 10-year-old or a 14-year-old, we're always wise. There's always a silent knowing within each one of us, right? There's always the creativity. Think what I said, the radiant mind of the child, it's always there. But what happens, the child uses a radiant mind to hide away when there are threats and to emerge when there's safety. And having that safe conversation with that child, I would love to have it with her, because there's something going on for her that needs attention.
And only she can... Yeah. Tony, another question here. I can't get my child to tidy up after himself. Any tips? Get one of those wooden spoons from from Ballymaloo.
Yeah, and so it's again, I also believe in having a family meeting, right, where we discuss how we can help each other in the family, how we can support each other, how we can share our tasks. And if a child is saying, I'm not doing it, I'll say, okay, tell me, how is it that you don't want to do it? I don't want to get cross. What's very important when there's a difference or the child is being oppositional, right? If I get cross, you do what I tell you. Now, which is more serious? The child not doing the task or me getting cross? Because my getting cross now is going to threaten the child. So I want to stay calm. I say, okay, tell me, how is it that you don't want to help me with the tasks? Because, you know, I need your help, right? What's happening for you? Or what do you need to be able to do the task I'm asking? But have the conversation again, but in that calm way. Any hint of crossness and the child may just close down.
Yeah, it's just walls.
Remember Tony always said.
Very interesting when you tease it out like that, isn't it?
Yes.
And I think a softly approach works best, doesn't it?
It does, because there's no threat. And I don't want to pose a threat, because if the threat then becomes more serious than the question, the particular issue that I want to address. Yeah. My getting cross is more serious issue to be tackled first.
Okay, very.
Remember, relationship before behavior.
Tony,
not behavior before relationship.
How do I manage an adolescent who is out of control?
Yeah, and I think a lot of the stories I told you gave the same idea of that, right? The boy with the aggression, beating his mother and so on, not responding to teachers, seemingly totally out of control. But of course, remember, all troubled behavior, when an adolescent is out of control, he's trying to draw attention to deep hurts that he doesn't feel safe enough to express yet. So let me give you the line. When a young person is troubled and troubling, they're not trying to make life difficult for others, they're trying to show how difficult life is for them. And is there anybody who will create a safe holding for him or her now to tell me what's happening for you? And watch the tone of voice. But I can assure you, there's a story behind the troubled behavior. Whereas if I just say, you do what I tell you and stop that bloody behavior now, of course, my behavior is more troubling than the one that the young person is showing. But be assured, all troubled behavior has a source.
Okay, very, very enlightening, Tony. I've really enjoyed that. And before we let you go, Tony, we're going to put up our poll first. So a little poll is going to pop up. While we're doing that, so the poll is just popping up, so we'd love to get your feedback on it. Let us know how you found that session with Dr. Humphreys. Tony, before we let you go, where can we find you online?
If you just Google Tony Humphreys, it'll come up all over the place, good and bad.
Every which way, Tony. TonyHumphreys.ie is that's where we've and for some fantastic expert parenting advice. Tony, before we go, we have our winner of this final section. Of course, you're the last one. They obviously say leave the best to last, right, Tony? Our winner of our final hamper here this afternoon is Michelle Doherty. So, Michelle, if you're with us, well done, and big congratulations to you, and thank you so much for taking part. Tony, I know you're going to leave us. Is there anything you want to say to all our HSC and frontline staff in Cork and Kerry this afternoon?
I was saying that at the very beginning, wasn't I? There's no greater wisdom than human kindness, and human kindness and the risks they put to their own well-being. You know, there's no words that can express the gratitude, but thank you.
Thank you. And that's a lovely message to leave it on. And a big congratulations to Michelle Doherty, your winner, and that will be out to you very soon. All right, Tony, thank you so much for your time today. We really appreciate it.
Okay.
I hope you stay safe and we'll see you soon. All right.
Thank you. Okay. Take care. Bye.
Okay, so before we wrap up, we just want to say a couple of thanks, a little bit of housework. I hope you've really enjoyed this afternoon. First up, I'd like to thank all our contributors from earlier on this morning, to Rob and Marion Heffernan and all the gang. We had a lovely fitness session. Also to Bernie Falvey and Nathan MacDonald. They were down in Ballyseedy Garden Centre up in Tralee. We had Richard Hogan, the psychotherapist. We also had Rachel Allen, who did some lovely cooking and baking. Can't wait to try that at home. They're down in Ballymaloe, their cookery school. And finally, to Dr. Tony Humphreys for those fantastic words of wisdom to finish out the day. Also, a massive thank you to all our staff here behind the camera here. There's a staff of 7 people. Give us a cheer there, guys. Who have been working very hard to put together this very special morning and afternoon for all you fantastic frontline staff across Cork and Inchkerry. To Niamh, Eilish, to Maura, to Caroline, Idel, Sharon, Priscilla and Carla. A big round of applause, come on. Woo! And also the man who made all this possible. He set up lights, camera, sound. He is a jack of all trades and he's a master of them too, to Craig. Big round of applause, big bullet bus. Craig. So we're going to finish out, guys, with a lovely special treat. We're going to move on here to our choir. Yes, the CUH Workplace Choir. They're called Scrubs, which is a fantastic name. I absolutely love it. The musical director is Patrick Dalton. And we're going to finish out this afternoon with a great song. And I think it's a song that resonates with so many of you and with so many people right up and down the country. For me and all the team here live from County Hall here in Cork, Bigi Cormac, we'll chat to you soon. Agus longa fó.
We all need somebody.